Ba 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 da, we are live. We're waiting for the timer to go down and they can hear us. And I've lost all my notes, but it doesn't matter. Oh yeah, history is fun. History is fun. It's not the Christmas episodes. Come on, stop blinking. The video's going to go. Come on. Oh my goodness. I leave far too long a pause thing. I think I've got something really important to say while this flashes 00. Hello, everybody. Welcome to What Did They Do Before? I am Izzy Lawrence, and next to me is the wonderful Caroline Lawrence. We share a surname and a love of history. Though we're not actually related, are we? We're not really.
You know, only in spirit. Only in spirit.
Exactly. And in name. And in spelling. Name.
Yes, absolutely. So why do we love history so much, Izzy?
I don't know. I just like stuff that's happened before, because it's like, I like stories. That's why I like it.
I love stories. But I think the reason, I've been thinking about this a lot, and I think one of the reasons I love history so much is that it's fascinating. There's this constant tension. How are they like us? And how are they different from us? And in that, we examine our own lives and what we're doing here on Earth, which is the greatest mystery of all, I think. So I think, and today's episode, we're talking about cameras. What did they do before cameras? Or more specifically, because you could have, Oh, cool.
I'm taking photos.
Photo as we speak.
Exactly, because this is the thing. This is what you can do. Look, you can see the other side of my messy desktop. There you go.
Cameras, because cameras is so huge and all-encompassing, you can take landscapes, you can do films. But I thought today we'd talk about portraits.
Okay. Portraits, mainly portraits.
Portraits, people, the whole concept. And again, thinking about what did they do? What were portraits in the past? What are they now? And by the way, just a disclaimer, don't believe anything we say today. We don't know anything. We know a little bit, but
you know more than me.
Well, the more I know, I don't know. As but the thing, the best historians don't just accept what they've heard. They think that's interesting. I'm just going to check it out. Those are the best historians. So I'd like you, as if we say interesting things, think, yeah, is that true? Is that right? And we're going to be opening a lot of questions. Like, for example, how would you define a portrait? How would you define a portrait, Izzy?
Well, it is, it's got to be, she says, not advertising your books anymore. That way up, not that way up. But it's got to be somebody's face, hasn't it? It's basically your face is your portrait, surely.
Okay, my idea was a portrait is any depiction in words or sculpture or painting of a specific person. And I've been asking my friends, what is the earliest portrait you can think of? Now, there's no right answer to this, so I'm putting you on the spot. I haven't asked you yet, Izzy, but new viewers out there, kids, what would you say the earliest depiction in word, or let's actually talk about in either sculpture or painting, or, 2D or 3D, of a specific person? So
that's not fair, because you're saying it has to be a specific person, because I was going to say it's a self-portrait, perhaps, and it's all those women who put their hands on the cave walls and got the paint and spat through their hands, so you've got these human handprints, and it's almost like, this is me, I was here, this is what I touched. And I was saying that's kind of portrait-like, because it's still them.
Okay, so I like that. So assuming that we've got the cave painting hand, let's say maybe that's abstract,
isn't it?
What's the first portrait that we would identify as a portrait, i.e. it's often the
head,
or the whole person, but let's especially think about, I was talking to a friend today, I was walking in the park, and I said, I thought one of the first portraits was the slide, if you want to bring it up.
Oh, yeah.
My friend Socrates, who was a wise philosopher who lived in about 450 BC. Mm-hmm. And Socrates, he lived in a time when sculpture was there was the classical period, when they did idealized people. So young people, old people, athletes, gods, all looked incredibly beautiful and perfect, and nobody could look that perfect. And then you've got this guy here, Socrates, and here's the fresco on the left, and the beautiful little sculpture from the British Museum on the right, about a foot tall, about as tall as my Roman ruler here. And you can see that he's got a really distinctive face. These are not classical good looks. He's got a snub nose, a little pudgy mouth, a bald head, bug eyes. And in fact, he looks a bit like Silenus, the king of the satyrs. He was a kind of mythical creature. And that made me think, maybe they kind of thought of him almost as a god. And in fact, we know their verbal descriptions, word descriptions of Socrates for describing him, like, well, he went around wearing a blanket and barefoot and with a walking stick, and he had a snub nose and bug eyes, and he was really ugly and big mouth and bald. And so maybe then they painted him to match the verbal description. But then my thinking, oh, maybe he looked like Silenus, a kind of god, made me think you often worshipped an image of someone. Those were the first sculptures, paintings, something you worshiped. And that reminded me of the second commandment. Do you remember the second commandment?
Honor thy father, one God before me.
Yep.
Honor thy father and thy mother? No.
That's number five. What's number two is no graven images, no carved or no images of any kind of anything on heaven or on earth or under the sea. The motive for that is so that God didn't want his people to worship idols. He wanted them to worship him, the invisible God. And that's
Can I just ruin the whole show and have a really fun fact about that?
Yeah.
You know, that before, when the Bible was being written, way that big empires used to take over places was they would go into their village and they would kidnap their gods. So they would take their gods, which were usually like oiled and beautiful statues, away and keep them in the central city so that the people there would have to obey what the central city says. Otherwise, they'd hurt their gods and then their crops would be ruined and everything else. And so it was really clever not to have an image of the god, because then they couldn't be taken away and you could be enslaved to the empire.
And that's just reminded me that, of course, they believed that an aspect of the god was in the image. So when you make an image, it's not just an image. There is the power of the god in whether it's a sculpture or a flat representation. So that's another reason you don't, you know, it's a very powerful thing to have an image of a person. Now, my friend who I was walking with in the park, who also suggested handprints, I said, okay, apart from handprints, what's one of the earliest portraits? And he came up with Nefertiti. Remember that bust of Nefertiti?
Oh, yeah.
And that's from 1345 BC. So that's way before Socrates. But again, is she idealized?
Well, technically that particular statue of her as the bust was really scary, because you always had Egyptians with their entire bodies were intact. And so to have somebody without the rest of their body, you know, they think that maybe that was just something that the artist was using to create the actual statues, because otherwise it was like a curse for her and that sort of thing. So
yeah, we'll come back to that in a minute, but tell me your fact. Do you have a fun fact?
Oh, I've got a fun fact. Okay, let me just do this. Well, basically, I always thought, what do we use portraits for now other than Instagram? And the main thing we use them for is passports. Because everybody has an official, like, sort of very formal, sort of looking slightly pasty and a bit ill, halfway through a burp. Passport photo, right? But in the past, what did they do before? Did they draw little pictures of their passports? But no, they didn't do this. They actually just had written passports. So if I go to here, so that's not a passport photo, that's a chicken. That's Galena, look at that. But here we have an Elizabeth I passport, one of her passports that she wrote for people. I mean, look at that signature. Can we just look at this?
It looks just like her.
Exactly. It's very, I am the queen. Here is my master signature, taking up all the space. This is her issuing a passport so that she could go, she, one of her subjects could go abroad and then come back again, because that was it. You couldn't leave certain areas without a passport. And this is what it looked like. And it was just the Queen going, I say that he can go there. But there's no actual description of him. It's just having it and bearing this particular piece of paper was enough to prove who you were. And it wasn't until much later that photographic passports came in, and I managed to, this is at the National Archives, I got to see one of the first ever. Now this one is Lloyd George, who is a British Prime Minister, but this is 1915, so he's actually Minister of Munitions at this time. And there you have his passport photo over there in the corner. Oops, excuse me. Over there in the corner, and as you can see, he's with the top hat in the shade. It's not very useful identity, is it? But here is really interesting. So here is his actual passport. So he's got his age, 52, because this is 1915, and his height, 5 feet 5 inches. His forehead, broad. His eyes, blue. His nose is straight. His mouth, straight, with good short, with short grey moustache. His chin, square. Colour of his hair, grey. Complexion, fresh. any special peculiarities? No. Exactly. Well, also, what does that tell you as well? It was genuinely assumed that if you were getting a passport and you were a British citizen, that you were white, despite the fact that all of the British Empire at this point was like at its peak and loads of British citizens were not white. It was assumed that if you wanted a passport, you were white. And if you have a look here as well, you've got the description of wife or applicant to be included in the passport. So, you know, if you want to go abroad, fella, your husband, you could just use his passport if you were on his. So that's pretty good. But I love the fact that they used oral descriptions. So they wrote down as if you could tell, you know, you could walk, I could walk through customs going, yes, I've got a very square chin, straight, and if I grew a grey moustache, it'd be perfect.
I love that description because it reminds me of the biographer Suetonius, who lived during the Caesars, the age of the Caesars in the first century AD, Roman biographer, who used to say, you know, he had Nero had watery blue eyes and reddish hair and spindly legs and things like that. Hot belly. And I love that. You know, it's one of the first descriptions. And one my favorite Latin poet, you all should know by now, my favorite two-line portrait of a person is you say all the beautiful women love you, Sextus, you who have the face of a man swimming underwater. The two lines tell it all. It doesn't just give you an image of Sextus's face, but his whole idea of his own worth and value, and kind of funny. I just
love it. Pomposity. So what have you got for us then? Well, that was passports.
I was thinking, you know, why do we take photos? I want to know what people look like, you know. So and I think some of the first portraits in history of ordinary people, not famous philosophers or gods or goddesses or pharaoh's wives, is are these ones from Egypt, from Roman Egypt. And I love these because looking at these paintings done on lime wood with colored wax called encaustic, often called mummy portraits because they were on Romans who lived in Egypt on their caskets. You really feel you're looking at a real person who lived 2,000 years ago. Actually, you're not quite because they have certain conventions. But look at that guy I snapped in Northern California and the guy on the right. They could be brothers. They're almost the same person.
Yeah.
They're usually young looking because people died early, but not always. And one of my favorites, the next slide, please, is this woman that I snapped from the British Museum. And she looks a bit, I have to say, she looks a bit like me. She's got the big brown eyes, the slightly graying hair, and a few wrinkles there. And it's lovingly done. And they've really emphasized the wrinkles. I think seeing an old person would have been an oddity. But if you look at the young man on the right, if you look very carefully, you see he's got the beginnings of a mustache.
Oh,
and
this is
something that you will notice on many of these Egyptian portraits. The young men have just the beginning of a mustache and a beard. And we think these are idealized. They may have looked like that or not. The point is, it wasn't a portrait that your mom would hang on the wall. These were on your grave to be buried. So they cost a lot of money. Why would you have a beautiful portrait of a young man just getting his mustache on a coffin. And one theory is that the fact that he's just beginning to get his mustache shows he's finally a real person. Whether he's just taken on the toga virilis, he's 16, he's become a man, or maybe in Jewish culture, he's had his bar mitzvah, he's 13 or 14. So these are usually young men, women aren't important, of course, between the, well, they are, but they're there. But young men between the ages of 14 and 20, and it shows they're real people. And one theory, this is an amazing theory, is that these portraits were to help the soul, identify itself so it could go into the next body. So it's about immortality. And if we have the final photo I brought today, this is of in the Mummy Gallery in the British Museum. And it's a beautiful, this is where you would get those portraits that we all know, but they would be on the outside of the mummy case. And we know that if you look carefully, right where his chest is, you can see some writing that tells us his name was Artemidorus. And he was young Greek. They've actually done DNA on him. He died about 20 years old. So sad. But luckily, there is a painting of him, so the soul knows next member of his family, maybe, to go into? I don't know, something like that.
I mean, it could be Peter Cook. He's got a bit of a Peter Cook-esque look to him. But it's nice to see people actually, you know, what they look like. And it is really... Yeah. It is the big difference between our generation now is that you see so many old people like me and Caroline around because we are ancient. You even go back to like Tudor times. Everybody's in their like, you know, late teenagers, early 20s, bad breath, rotten teeth, you know, and they're dying really young. So it's one of these things. You go back to the past and everybody's really hip and trendy and cool.
Yeah.
So we've run out of time, unfortunately, but we will be back next week where we will be getting all festive, won't we? Because I want to do festive stuff. Yes.
Christmas.
What are Christmas. We doing for Christmas? Or even just some sort of, you know, dark spiritual pagan times.
Ooh, yeah, pagan. Yeah.
Exactly. So thank you very much for watching. If you give us a like, a share, a subscribe, if you tell people that we're doing this every Thursday at 4 p.m, then we will continue doing this every Thursday at 4 p.m. Otherwise, we may stop and go, meh.
Me.
Nah. We'll see you next week. Bye-bye.
Bye.